Welcome to the Mr. Paintbrush. Today we're going to talk about painting up a 1/24 scale Mustang Cobra Shelby. For those of you who have been here, you know that I'm an avid wargamer and I love painting miniatures, but I also paint 1/24 scale models. I do like model building and it has been a passion of mine. If you're new to the channel, welcome and enjoy. Alrighty, time to build a 66 Cobra Shelby GT350, not the H variety. We're gonna do a little different. Take a look at the box, brand new, fresh and clean. I'm building this for my sister-in-law who is an avid lover of Shelby Cobras, as am I. For those of you who do not know, Carol Shelby was the one that took an AC Bristol, a British racing car, and shoved the biggest Ford engine it possibly could into basically what was a go-kart. Dangerous, yes. Unpredictable, absolutely. You needed to have nerves of steel to drive these things? That's an understatement. But I'll tell you this much, it gave Ferrari a run for its money. Well, Ford Motor Company was all on that and then contracted Carol Shelby to produce their pony car and upgrade it, since it came out in 1964 1/2. That's the first Mustang ever come out. This one is 1966, a couple of years later, when Carol Shelby came onto the scene. And again, taking that tried and true method of cramming the largest engine they possibly could into that engine bay, shoehorning it with just like inches to spare on either side, and really, really put a performance beast out there that, if you didn't know how to drive, could be actually dangerous. Suspension back then was still spring leaf and not as good as racing car engines. So if you didn't know what you were doing, you can get yourself in trouble. These have been the elites of the Ford Motor Company's some of the elite cars the Ford Motor Company has put out. The Cobra Shelby has a legacy within it, and quite the history, American history, when it comes to racing and scaring the pants off of Ferrari, which it did in Le Mans, actually. It won against Ferrari in the later vehicle. All right, so, so satisfying, clipping those sprues, getting the engine component down. We're going to get the engine component together, and I'm going to show you what to do. If you've never seen me do this before, I'm using the edge of an X-Acto blade, and I'm scraping the mold lines off. And you know, you can go in there with a file as well, but this is a technique that I use, both sides of the X-Acto blade, to get rid of mold lines. Mold lines occur when several pressing of the models, when you gotta inject mullet, when they release that mold. Sometimes if you make millions and millions and millions of copies, those molds get warped and a little bit of flashing occurs around the piece. I believe in Ravel, I don't know if they've ever updated their molds lines, their mold presses. All right, so speaking of which, this was warped. And warping happens when they don't give it enough time to cool from the molding process, and they put it into the container, and then it just bends to whatever is pressing against it. Now, take a little heat gun there, and I bend the back into place. Be careful with heat guns. You can melt your model quite easily. Another alternative is to boil your piece and then shape it gently. That's the easiest way, but I have a heat gun, and I'm bold. All right, so I put the side scoops on, and now I'm going to get rid of the mold lines on the body itself. You want to make sure that the body is actually perfectly smooth, so when you lay on the paint, it doesn't show through. I'm using 1,000 grit there. Sandpaper. All right, time for a scroller. I'm going to scribe out the panel lines here, and I do have a link in the description if you want to pick this up. And what it does is the recesses, it makes it deeper and makes it look like the door actually opens, even though it does not. So just it's important just to be really, really careful when doing this, and do it lightly at first and then go a little deeper each pass. You don't want to go too hard or too aggressive the first time over, because that scriber can walk on you and then scratch your paint job, and it's going to kind of ruin your day. And you're going to have to putty it up and then sand it up, all the scratch marks, and this is a pain to work with. So be very, very careful. Speaking of which, I'm going to remove a little excess right there with the 1000 grit sandpaper that I have. Again, I'm just going to scroll this out. I'm going to show you, if you've never seen this tool before, I want to show you exactly how to use it. Those people in wargaming, I don't think this is a much of a tool that a lot of people do use, but I do have it in my arsenal. It may come in handy. So you wargamers are actually watching this video. Check that out. New techniques for you. All right. So the engine, I put a little too much glue on there, but that's all right. I mean, I'm trying to get rid of some gaps that it might have. So boop, there it is. I use these clamps. These clamps are really great. And they're Irwin and they're Sure Grips. Also, I have this product in the link to the description. If you click on the news link, it's an Amazon affiliate link. The channel does get a kickback if you buy any of these products. Okay. Now using pill bottles and poster tack, I actually do sub-assemblies onto, this way I can paint them separately. Okay, starting to build as much of the interior as possible, actually much of the model as possible before I paint. So I'm getting the armrests in there and everything situated, so it's when I paint, it'll be a lot quicker. Okay, so trying to do the underside, because I do want the roof liner to be in flat black, so I have a black interior, so I'm going to do that. I'm also going to hit the engine bay as well and other little bits. Notice that I'm not masking anything off. I'm trying something new here. Hopefully it won't like blow up in my face, but we'll see. Okay, I'm gonna do the engine bay as well. Again, not masking off. Oh no, there's overspray. You knew that was gonna happen. Everybody knew it was gonna happen. I knew it was gonna happen. That's okay. There's that pill bottle with the poster tack to hold it into place. Just interesting. I'm gonna do the bottom of the hood, the cowl, or if you're from Europe, the bonnet. Getting that in as well. And then, yes, the tunnel. I've forgotten to do the actual tunnel, transmission tunnel before. Not this time. Okay, not this time. And then powder coat the chassis. Actually, just airbrush the chassis. And again, doing it in a primer. I like to use Steinores primer. Steinores is from Badger. It works. I'm also going to do the interior where possible as well. Just hitting in and just priming up the pieces. Okay, so what about that overspray? Okay, a little bit of alcohol will do ya on a little piece here. And I'm just going to clean it and watch the overspray come right off. Isn't that amazing? That is absolutely amazing. And you can get fine lines this way. And plus, if some of the stuff in the recesses stay, like that black in the recess for the headlight, that's fine, because it just accents your lines, your panel lines. Okay, so time for some tape. I use a whole bunch of tape. Tape down in the description as well. Amazon affiliates, if you want to pick any of these up. Tamiya tapes are great. Frog tape is great. Now they have a frog tape for delicate surfaces. I haven't tried that out yet, but I am going to soon, because I'm really interested to see how that works. But the frog tape works as well. And make sure you get into the recess. Sometimes you take a toothpick and go along the side as well. And you may want to actually trim out some of the excesses, so this way it fits nicely. And I'll show you how to do that with some scissors right there. You just clip out the excesses right here and here. Same thing I do with decals to make them fit. And you're just making the masking fit. Now, getting the masking perfect, it is essential here. Okay, so there it is, the masking, just tapping off everything so nothing gets overspray on it. Now I'm being very careful. I'm not being willy-nilly like before. Okay, time to prime it. I'm priming with a gray Steinores primer. I do like Steinores primers. They are self-leveling, which is definitely a boon for me. Okay, time to taint it white. Again, white Steinores primer as well, just getting that. And I take the Steinores primer and actually I add a drop of FW ink to it, so adding some ink to there. I'm painting the whole thing white. It'll make the blue later on that I'm planning to paint this pop a little more. And plus, having that stark white when it comes to those racing stripes that I'm going to custom make onto these. All right, black Steinores primer onto the interior. Now the interior is going to be I have two different kind of textures in there. I'm gonna have that flat black, and then I am actually gonna have like a semi-gloss for the leather bits and stuff like that, and I'll show you how I do that in just a bit. All right, time for the engine, and I wanna go for a Laguna Blue. You can use anything. I've used Minotaur, and the reason I'm using Minotaur is because I kind of just wanna go through the paint. I have a lot of paint, and I kind of like can't justify buying more paint unless, you know, I go through some of this paint. So for larger projects, I try to use as much of the Minotaur that I use, but you can use any blue you want. Two, you can actually get the actual color code match for the engine bay for 1966 if you wanted to go that far. Now, time for the stripes. I put on two pinstripes right there, and that hood cowl is actually shaped differently. So what I did was I make a photocopy of the decals itself, and I traced out the design to notice that it's going out to in. It's not just straight lines. So it's quite involved to get the racing stripes on there. This is something new. I've never done custom racing stripes before. Taking the pinstripe there, and I am taping it down to the opposite side now of the copy that I made, and I traced out on the opposite side of that just to secure that. And once I do that, I'm going to fold this paper over to make it nice and thick. Notice I have an X-Acto blade in my hand, and that tracing lines that I do, I am literally going to cut the trace marks, but I am going to use a ruler to go through and cut those lines as straight as possible. And in turn, I'm actually cutting the masking stripes to get it done. And those are the angle that I needed. I'm just going to cut off the excess from the tape that I put down there. And this is how I actually achieved pretty good results when it comes to exacting these stripes. Since this model did not come with white stripes, it only came with gold stripes. But I, as the commission, they wanted white stripes. So there you go. So, okay, now time to put it in. Very important you get the masking done right here. All right, when you mask right, then your results are amazing. If you don't mask right, then ugh, no bueno. So yeah, you can use Tamiya tape. I had some extra masking pinstripe tape that I used. This way I have the uniformity right there. And I really am going to fuss to make sure that the masking is done right. Now on the side, I have different layers. And since I don't have the GT350 emblem on there, I'm just going to do some side stripes straight across, taking some liberty here to do that. Again, I do not have white stripes, and I didn't order white stripes, so I'm actually just creating it. And this is the fun part of this build, because I've never done that before, and I always wanted to try to do some pinstriping onto a car and see what it would be like. So there it is, the three stripes right there. Looking pretty good, actually. It actually looks really good white with the red stripes there, although that's just tape. All right, so time to take that Laguna Blue that they, again, sister-in-law wanted blue. She did not want me to actually purchase the original paint, which I'm used to actually purchasing the actual original paint for the model, but she's like, don't buy any more paint. So I'm like, okay, fine, I won't buy any more paint, and I'll just use the Laguna Blue. And I mean, it came out all right. It's not the best paint job I've ever done, certainly not. Again, this is a learning curve. Now I'm going to do some compound here, and I'm using Tamiya compound coarse, fine, and finish. And you can see the compound to get rid of some of the imperfections from the paint, and I'm going to go through it. It's like doing a wax for your car. Okay, tester's gloss coat now, and I'm going to do that outdoors, not inside, so I'm going to skip on to after I am done with that. All right. Go to mask the inside interior next, because I do want that flat black for the floors, but I do want a semi-gloss kind of satin sheen for the seats and the leather bits and vinyl bits inside the car. So I'm going to hit that as well with a satin sheen, and that's what I'm doing. I use microscale satin, but you can use any satin sheen. I mean, there's so many that you can use here. But again, I have excess of satin sheen, so... I'm going to try to use the micro scale because I have it and I want to use it. And it actually comes out pretty good. All right, so I'm going to reveal the masking. You can see the two textures there, the glossy one as well as the matte one. And I think it came out really well to differentiate the different textures of the interior. I'm really happy the way the interior came out. The exterior paint job, I've done better, I have to say. Personally, I wanted to get the match, the coat just right. From the factory and use the actual paint, but since I'm using miniature paint, it came out all right. It's something I've never done before, use miniature paint in order to paint a model car. Now what I'm doing is I'm going to hit it off with some Pledge floor polish for a reflective shine. Yes, you can use floor polish. All right, all the chrome bits over here, these pieces weren't chrome, they were aluminum, so I'm painting them with Vallejo metal color aluminum. Okay, time to get the trim on the interior, and I'm actually using a Sharpie, a metallic Sharpie to do that. You could use a lot of things, but this is like a little trick that I've learned how to use from the scale modeling industry, and some people in the miniature model modeling world actually incorporated this as well. And it's just an easy way to have control over doing edge highlighting. So you can actually use edge highlighting with the markers if you wanted to. And I like the black background because even if I mess up, I can, like over here for the glove box, I could just paint over it. There you go. And I can clean it up with the black. So easy. All right. I painted the, it's a wooden wheel for the original car. So I painted it leather brown around there, the steering wheel. And then I'm going to hit it off with an ink later. Okay. Getting the Vallejo metal color for the center arms piece. And now I'm hitting with that, Intense wood. And that is from scale 75. I put that on there and it actually simulates wood very well. I'm very happy with the way that came out. All right, doing the wheel wells here because I forgot to do the wheel wells. So willy-nilly, not masking, I am going to go in there with a I'm going to go in there with a Herder and Steinbeck CR Plus, which has the smallest needle in an airbrush. All right, building the engine and building the pieces onto the bottom. Did a lot of building in here. Usually, I don't include the building part of model building. Weird, huh? When I build my when I put together my wargaming material, but this one, when it comes to scale modeling, I do like to include the build process as well. Okay, going into the interior dashboard, and what I did was I took ink, and I tried to do ink with a little bit of black paint and getting that nice chrome and white dial, like that white, fresh white and black look to it. I'm gonna add the steering column onto it. Really came out well. I'm really happy with the interior. I really am satisfied with how the interior came out. A lot more satisfied than the exterior. I've done better paint jobs. But next time I learned a lot from it. And that's where I'm gonna leave it at. You know, every model I learned something from, and that is the point of me building models. Okay, so putting it all together, I'm gonna tie in the exhaust pipes later, but I'm putting in the oil filter. Oh, look at that interior. So satisfying. The textures came out just right. I am so happy with that. Ah, all right. Next, I'm doing the water bottle. Water bottles, people don't know me. I go a little cartoony with my water bottles, just the way it is. Stanol Res Primer, I'm doing gray first. And then while it dries, I'm going to do the wheels. That's right. The wheels itself will come all in chrome. So I painted the black and the inserts. Now I'm going to go back to the water bottle because it's dry. I'm going to paint white onto it on the top. And I'm gonna like simulate some fluid in there. I'm just using blue. I could have done green in retrospect, but that's okay. You can do it when you build your model. You can do it any color you want. Just doing bottles is fun for me. Okay, so for the tires, I'm actually shaving it down with a file. It simulates that you've driven the car before. So I like to do that and rough up some of the treads there. Okay, putting the wheels together. I really am happy the way that came out. You want to paint those things black to really actually become realistic. If you don't paint them, it kind of looks more like a plastic car instead of a real car. So that's what I'm trying to go for there. Fan onto the fan belt assembly and going back to that water bottle, which I'm painting the white into a beige color right there because I know the water bottles are a little bit like a beige kind of yellowish color. And then with a micron pen, I'm going to delineate the water level. I'm going to assemble the fan assembly onto the engine. It is coming together, slowly but surely coming together. Alrighty, and put the interior on. Boop. next up, I'm using that Sharpie technique to, just to do the chrome around here. I do have other methods to do chrome on here, but I kind of want to do this quickly. Again, this is what you call a palette cleanser, going from one very large project with the Flesh Eater quartz that I did prior, and I'm going on to, you know, just freshening up my palette by trying different things. Now I'm using a clear glue over here from Testers. They do have clear glue for glass, and I'm just situating that, because the clear glue, if you use regular super glue, it frosts and you don't want that. So using that clear glue from Testers for windows is perfect. All right, gently setting the glass into place. You don't want any kind of overleaks with the glue or anything like that. Okay, now doing the headlights, I'm doing it white. I'm trying to leave the edges of the headlights unpainted so it has like that chrome rim around it. Doing some clear amber now from Tamiya paint, and I'm just filling in the turn signals. I love the clear line that Tamiya puts. I use it for so many things. Oil wash now, mixing some oil paint with some mineral spirits. So this way it'll actually do a recess wash and leave the chrome bits on the top. So easy to do, and you get to see how it travels. If you have never done an oil wash, take some oil paint, put some mineral spirits, dilute it, and then go to town. Just make sure you give it enough time to dry. It usually dries in 24 to 72 hours, so just make sure you allow it enough time to dry. And I'm going to do the same for these for these covers here, and again, it just does a great job. Okay, doing some clear red from Tamiya for the brake lights. And you just have to be really careful, as I'm doing right here, to be able to do those and to leave the chrome on the outside. Putting in that mirror, just setting in with some tweezers, and now fitting the body onto the chassis, which is a process, usually, especially with the Revell and AMT models and stuff. And I'm really worried because the fit usually does not work well. That's why I like to build Tamiya models, as well as Soma and Fujimaya. Those are really nice, but these sometimes give me trouble. This one didn't give me much of a problem, so I'm very relieved about that. All right, time for the radiator, and just putting on the engine bits and the bracing bar there. Getting the air cleaner and the grill on. And everything is coming out really well. The build process is a lot of little different pieces to put onto this model here. Getting those brake lights in, using poster tack to hold it steady and letting it dry. That's a different technique that I use as well. Painting up the battery terminals and the braces as well on the tip for the shocks, which I noticed were red on the box, so I'm just gonna simulate that. All right, there's that water bottle that goes onto the side that we worked on there. I'm putting the pieces together. Really starting to come in. Time for the headlights. Putting in the chrome bits first, and then moving on to the glass bits. Again, using that window glue is really important, so you have no frosting. Putting on the mirror and assembling the front bumper, as well as the turn signals using that poster tack technique that I use. And then putting on the glass for the back windows. Yeah, settling in with the poster tack and using a tweezers in order to hold it. And there it is. It is all done. Again, exterior paint, not where I would like to do, but I'm very highly critical of my work. But the first time I ever did stripes, and I'm really, really proud of it. Looking pretty good, and I really hope my sister-in-law enjoys it. Excellent palette cleanser. If you've never done 124 scale models, I encourage you to go for it and try something new and adventurous. It's a great palate cleanser. Alrighty, well, I'll catch you on the outro. Peace. Alright, well, there it is, and it's a gift for my sister-in-law. I hope she really does enjoy it. Alright, well, If you like this video and like to support the channel, number one, sharing this video with others is the kindest thing you could possibly do for the channel to help the channel grow. Second, I do have Amazon affiliate links with some of the products that I use, tried, tested, and true, for me anyway. And if you click on the links and buy one of those products, the channel gets a kickback. But if you don't want to do any of that, that's fine. I'm just glad you came to hang out. Alright, well, if you like this video, like, share, comment, and subscribe, and we'll catch you next time on the Miniatures Paintbrush.